And hello again, everyone. I'm Chris Lincoln, and welcome again to Oklahoma Sportscene across the state of Oklahoma, and here from the Billy Sims Barbecue, 51st and Sheridan, in the Farm Shopping Center. Take a look at our show lineup for this week. It's a good one for you. Oklahoma City Thunder preview. We'll have Nick Gallo, their sideline TV reporter. Also, Michael Knight was at their recent preseason game in Tulsa. A special feature for you there, too. Tulsa Oilers have open tryouts. Want to become a football player, a professional football player? We can join Luke Hamilton of the Oilers. Have all the details for you. Talk about the upcoming preparations for the Oilers' first inaugural season, indoor football, coming to Tulsa next March. Robert Taylor, our judge memorabilia guy, is going to be here with some incredible items for you. Talk about the baseball that Aaron Judge had out of the park. The 60 seconds is going to be worth a whole lot of money. He also has some items he owns himself of Aaron Judge, so I think you'll enjoy that as well. Then a very topical story on concussions. Dr. Christopher Crane from Tulsa Bone and Joint will be here to talk about sports concussions, and it's really something you all need to hear and pay attention to. Then, to make you Sooner fans feel better, how about a blast from the past? Tinker Owens, their two-time All-American receiver, recent inductee into the Oklahoma Sports Hall of Fame, will join us to talk about Sooner football and about his great career. Let's take a look now at the latest Associated Press college football poll, week number 7. Interesting, we had quite a shakeup in the top 5. In fact, there's a new number 1 in the AP Top 25 poll, and every spot in the top 5 has changed with a new team this week. Georgia won with 32 first-place votes. Ohio State jumps to 2nd, 20 first-place votes. Alabama slips to 3rd with 11 first-place votes. Oklahoma State winning, still undefeated, but they went from 6 down to 8. TCU, the Big 12, is now 13. Kansas State, 17. The Jayhawks, people still love them. They stayed in the top 20, number 19, despite the close loss last weekend. And then Texas gets in the top 25, tied for 22. Now, how do you feel as Sooner fans? Number 25, among the best college football teams in America, James Madison. Pitiful. All right, take a look at our Big 12 schedule this week. It starts on Thursday night, actually. It'll be Baylor at West Virginia. And then on Saturday, it'll be Kansas at Oklahoma, 11 a.m. kickoff for the Sooners on ESPN2. Iowa State at Texas, that's an 11 a.m. kickoff as well. That's on ABC. Oklahoma State is a big game of the weekend. The undefeated Cowboys, number 7 in the nation, 8 in the AP poll. Take on number 13, TCU. That'll be on ABC at 2:30. Cowboys lead that series 17-13-2. Last meeting, last year, Oklahoma State pounded the Frogs 63-17. Hope for more of that coming up. FC Tulsa this past Saturday, their home match with Monterey Bay FC had to be canceled. They rescheduled that for this Wednesday the 12th. Then their final home match coming up on Saturday, October the 15th. We come back, Thunder Up, Oklahoma City Thunder on Oklahoma Sports Scene.
Get down with monsters and money this Rocktober at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Win up to $1 million October 15th, 22nd, and 29th. Take a chance and be one of 15 lucky winners rocking their way to the bank. Then, don't miss our $10,000 costume party. Dress to impress October 29th from 7 p.m. to 2 a.m. and become one of 10 scary winners to claim some cash. Only at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa.
The Tulsa Oilers are back on the ice with a new owner, a new look, and a new attitude. Save big on season tickets today, 2022-23 season. Tickets starting as low as $17 per month. Get your season tickets at TulsaOilers.com. TulsaOilers.com. Experience hard-hitting, glove-dropping, pulse-pounding, glass-rattling kind of thrill. Season tickets available now at TulsaOilers.com. This is your town, your team, your Tulsa Oilers are back.
Billy Sims knows barbecue. How about 9 meats, including brisket, chicken, pork, turkey, and ribs? Just to name a few, and 7 homestyle sides. We start early to slow smoke the most delicious meats for over 12 hours.
Every day.
Wherever you want, online, dine in, curbside, or carry out. We've had a passion for over 15 years of serving delicious barbecue to people like you. Billy Sims has fast, drop-in friendly neighborhood service, loud enough for a tailgate and fancy enough for a wedding. Like we said, Billy Sims knows barbecue.
Well, for the 13th time since the Oklahoma City Thunder moved from Seattle to Oklahoma in 2008, the team came down I-44 to Tulsa this past week for a preseason game at the BOK Center against the Dallas Mavericks. My guy Michael Knight was there to capture some of the sights and sounds of NBA basketball in Tulsa. The Thunder finished last season with a 24-58 record. They finished in fifth place in the Northwest Division, 14th in the Western Conference, and missed the playoffs for the second straight year in a rebuilding process. They opened the 2022-23 season, the NBA's 77th season. They'll be on the road October 19th at Minnesota, then the 22nd at Denver. They come home for their first home game. They'll play, in fact, three straight home games in Oklahoma City. They'll be taking on October the 23rd versus Minnesota, back-to-back games with the Los Angeles Clippers then. Then the NBA season, 82 games, 41 home games, starts on October 18th, runs to the regular season on April the 9th. Team's regular TV sideline reporter, Nick Gallo, joined us with a preview.
We welcome to the program Nick Gallo, a TV sideline man for the Oklahoma City Thunder. Another season here. Nick, ready to tip off Thunder basketball. Of course, just had you last week in Tulsa for our preseason game. But give us the outlook for this 22-23 Thunder team.
Well, I would say a very exciting group. The youngest team in the NBA, the second youngest team in NBA history, only to last year's Thunder team. And what that means is a long runway ahead. And so I think what we're going to see this season is continued growth. We're going to be looking for those catalyst moments, those moments where guys are clearly taking steps forward. And then I think that we can look on the horizon and say, hey, when some of these players, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, Josh Giddey, Lugansdort, Jalen Williams, the other Jalen Williams, you know, some of these guys, as they progress, as they kind of hit the primes of their careers and those arcs overlap, we're going to be looking at some really exciting basketball in the state of Oklahoma, and a great opportunity for this team to have another run of success like it had previously. So that's the overarching goal. Each season is part of a series of seasons that is building towards that goal.
Hard to believe the Thunder's been in Oklahoma City now since 2008. And you mentioned some of the success they had, the division title 2010-11, Western Conference Finals, NBA Finals 2011-2012, but no playoffs since 2020. And I know the fans are anxious, the rebuilding goes on. What a gut punch we took though, Nick, with the big guy, Chet Holmgren, our number one draft pick going down.
Yeah, it's, you know, tough. Obviously, there's nothing you can do about kind of a freak accident like that. You know, it was an acute injury where something happened on the floor in a game. This is not like a wear and tear injury or anything like that. But the prognosis is good. He will miss the entire season. But, you know, I think this is going to be a wonderful opportunity for Chet Holmgren to learn the NBA, to learn his teammates, learn how to be a professional at the NBA level, and understand the cadence and the tempo of scouting, prep for games, how to be on top of everything before you start a game in this league. And then, you know, he's also got a few guys that he can look at over the course of time who have had this exact situation and come back and had a wonderful true rookie year. So you think about Joel Embiid and Ben Simmons and Blake Griffin. Those guys were all top three picks and missed their rookie years, came back, had wonderful second seasons. And then even in-house, the Thunder's very own Nick Collison missed his entire rookie year. And so he has some great wisdom to impart about how to handle that maybe disappointment of missing your first year, but using that time to the best of your ability. So should be very exciting. And I tell you what, when the Thunder gets him back in a year's time and is able to mesh him with the rest of this group, it will certainly be very exciting.
Hey, Nick, what can the fans expect? I mean, we're not going to go through another rebuilding and talk about losing games, the in for draft situations, are we? What's the prospects?
Well, I mean, every season is going to unfold as it does. You know, I don't think that the Thunder comes into any year with preconceived notions about what the team is going to be. I think we can point exactly to the 2019-2020 season that you mentioned. Everybody was predicting that Thunder team to win like 13 games, 20 games, something like that. Well, they go on and when the season shut down on March 11th, 2020, they were battling for the fourth spot in the Western Conference. So the Thunder didn't go into that season saying, you know, hey, we have this notion, this idea of what this team is going to be. They kind of let that team declare itself on its own. And that's going to be the same. That was the same situation last year and the year before. And it's going to be the same this year as well. You know, I think if you look at the history of teams that have rebuilt in the modern NBA, the fact that the Thunder was in a game seven of a playoff series just about two calendar years ago is really not that long ago. I mean, you think about the summer of 2020 when the bubble was happening. 2 years of a rebuild is not a very long time. So I think having that perspective of what the normal arc of a rebuild is like throughout the course of the NBA should help fans recognize the need for patience and for the fact that you have this many young, talented players on the roster already with this massive amount of draft picks ahead. You got to feel very positive about the direction of the organization.
Yeah, give us a look at some of these key players. And also, I think we have another seven-footer, right? Can Serbia coming in?
Yes, yeah. So Alexei Pokuševski, this will be his third season. He's really a very well-rounded, I would say, classic European player. I mean, this is a serious guy that can shoot, can dribble, can pass especially, can be a connector for the team out there on the floor. So this is a guy that, you know, he's developed. He's gone to the G League each of the last two seasons and has come back a better player after those two seasons and those stints in the G League. So he'll mesh in with a guy that we all know very well, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, who, 24 point per game scorer last year. Josh Giddey, who was excellent in his rookie season, was a triple-double threat almost every night. Lou Dort is just a defensive ace out there. He is just that physical embodiment of what the Thunder wants to be about, diving on the floor, hustling, not backing down from anyone. Then you've got veteran pieces like Kenrich Williams, who's been in the league now. This is his fifth season. And you've got Mike Muscala, that veteran pick and pop 3-point shooter as a 6'11" guy. So this is a team that's going to have some well-rounded players and kind of a diverse roster, and we'll be able to mix and match. You're going to see all different sorts of lineups. Right now, the Thunder is about discovery. What can we throw out there on the floor and make sure that the group is greater than the sum of its parts?
We come back here on Oklahoma Sports Scene. We'll return to football with our Tulsa Oilers, the new Indoor Professional Football League team, coming in March. Be joined by Luke Hamilton, your play-by-play voice, to talk about open tryouts. You could be an Oilers football player.
You did it, Tulsa. You name the team.
We name the team.
You name the team. The Tulsa Oilers indoor football team kicks off in March, Saturday nights, 7 p.m., BOK Center. Season tickets are on sale now. Go to TulsaOilersFootball.com. That's TulsaOilersFootball.com to get your season tickets now. Don't miss your chance to experience the fast pace, helmet hitting, pad popping excitement of professional indoor football. TulsaOilersFootball.com. TulsaOilersFootball.com.
Billy Sims knows barbecue. How about 9 meats, including brisket, chicken, pork, turkey, and ribs? Just to name a few, and 7 home-style sides. We start early to slow smoke the most delicious meats for over 12 hours.
Every day.
Wherever you want, online, dine in, curbside, or carry out. We've had a passion for over 15 years of serving delicious barbecue to people like you. Billy Sims has fast, drop-in friendly neighborhood service, loud enough for a tailgate and fancy enough for a wedding. Like we said, Billy Sims knows barbecue.
Get down with Monsters and Money this Rocktober at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Win up to $1 million October 15th, 22nd, and 29th. Take a chance and be one of 15 lucky winners rocking their way to the bank. Then, don't miss our $10,000 costume party. Dress to impress October 29th from 7 p.m. to 2 a.m. and become one of 10 scary winners to claim some cash. Only at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa.
Hi, I'm Dr. Caleb Nelly with Tulsa Bone and Joint in Owosso.
And I'm Dr. Ian Goodman with Tulsa Bone and Joint in Owosso, and we are your team physicians for the Owosso Rams.
I'm Zach McGinty.
I'm Kate Grady.
I'm Destry Millsap.
And we are the athletic trainers for the Owosso Rams.
Here's some of the services that we provide in the Tulsa Bone and Joint Athletic Training Facility.
Back at Oklahoma Sports Scene, it's football time in Oklahoma, as you well know. The college, high school going on, and also looking forward to football in March in Oklahoma. That's when our new indoor football league team, the Tulsa Oilers, take the field. Luke Hamilton will be their play-by-play voice, also having media for the Oilers football team. I'm going to get my Oilers football and my hockey together now. Luke, let's talk about big open tryouts coming up. Those people still think they can play football, which they could want to play football. Where do they have to come and what do they have to do?
Yeah, absolutely. So, in the Indoor Football League, there's an opportunity for an open tryout for just about every franchise in the league every year. Super exciting to be able to have it as one of our biggest first events as a franchise here in Tulsa. It'll be on October 22nd. You can register on our website, TulsaOilersFootball.com. It's an opportunity for a lot of talent, not only locally, but just really across the nation to be able to come here and showcase their talent. A lot of speed and skill drills will be involved, and it's going to be exciting.
We have the Titan Sports Complex. It's out there at 81st Street in South Tulsa. Open tryouts will be, again, from noon to 3 p.m. You're asked to bring your own shoes, right? Turf shoes, a pair of shorts, T-shirt. You can find a T-shirt and some water, I guess.
Yeah, right? Absolutely. Well, hopefully they'll need some water after the workout, without a doubt. But everybody will get a T-shirt, a Tulsa Oilers T-shirt involved as well. An opportunity for everybody to showcase not only skill drills, but speed drills, and as well as some team drills. Of course, with the Indoor Football League being a unique sport in the vein of football, you'll get a lot of traditional football players that'll have to learn that style of game. It'll give them an opportunity to showcase skills that are advantageous towards the indoor football style of game.
This is professional football, so there is a charge. There's a pre-registration fee and a fee the day of the event. Talk about that, too.
Yeah, absolutely. So you can register and pay online with the same link on our website. So it's an opportunity for everybody to pay up front, or you pay just a little bit more at the day of the tryout if you'd like to as well.
$50, I think, the pre-registration.
Yeah, about $51, okay. I think, after tax.
Right, so. Okay. And again, the team will provide the T-shirts and the water. You can provide your own shoes and the shorts for that there. Okay, let's talk about some early signings now. We got some guys that have been signed to professional contracts with our Tulsa Oilers Indoor Football League team. One, in fact, as we tape on Monday, just announced today, local guy.
Yeah, absolutely. Christopher Ivey. We're super excited to announce him on the line here for us. A local Tulsa Hurricane, of course, as of recently graduated. He's a really talented player, but not only that, head coach Marvin Jones emphasized his leadership skills as well. This is a guy that has started 12 games in a season before, played in 12 games in a season before, experience against Oklahoma State, UCA, some big schools for sure. So we're excited to have him on board.
Tell me something about the signings. Right away, you signed a quarterback. You also signed an Oklahoma State kid, too.
Yeah, absolutely. So we started off signing James Summers, a quarterback out of East Carolina University. And when you're looking for a quarterback at this level, you're not only looking for a guy that can throw the football well, but you're looking for a guy that can move his feet quickly, right? It's such a small field compared to traditional football. But this is a guy that can get contact 5-10 yards extra after contact. That's a big chunk of the field in indoor football, and he's been able to prove that at the D1 college level, and we'll be able to see him a lot there. Deontay Cruz is the other guy that we were able to grab, a lineman out of Oklahoma State, played at Northeastern as well, Northeastern Oklahoma. He is another big-bodied player that has a ton of experience. Not only was he at Oklahoma State, but he's got experience in arena football, and that goes a long way with signing guys to a brand-new franchise.
Is the fact the Sooners are 3-3 and got such a beat down by Texas, I mean, you don't have any OU players that on the team yet?
It is a new era, it seems, for Oklahoma football, unfortunately. Wow. But, boy, hopefully we'll be able to grab some Sooners at some point. You look at the pedigree that the program has, and I'll take anybody, fourth-string or first-string from that program typically.
Head coach Marvin Jones has also been building his staff. Talk about some of his new assistants he's added.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's growing and it will continue to grow as we release some signings on the coaching staff here eventually. But Lewis Class has worked with head coach Marvin Jones quite a bit in his career. He'll be helping out with the defensive line as well as just player development and personnel. He's an exciting sign for sure. It is nice that head coach Marvin Jones has built relationships with some of these guys already so that the chemistry can be built right out of the gate. Todd Walkenhorst experience not only with the University of Nebraska but as well with the Kansas City Chiefs in the NFL will be our team analyst. He's going to be able to help us as far as getting film, as far as letting these guys that are rookies learn the game of indoor football quickly and without hesitation at the end of the day. And Joshua Resignalo, our offensive coordinator, he's got experience with our quarterback, James Summers, coached him quite a bit. So that's going to be a huge piece to getting off to a hot start here in Tulsa.
Again, I bring up every time I meet with either you guys or the Ice Oilers too, Andy Skirno. My gosh, what a dynamic person. He is really putting the money up here. He wants a high quality product.
Yes, he does, and that's the biggest part about it, I think, right? Is there's not really any spare of expense with Andy Skirto as far as making sure that this community gets the best product possible. And he's a go-getter. He doesn't hesitate on anything that he wants to get done. He evaluates it, and once he recognizes it's an opportunity to benefit for the community, he makes it happen. 10 times out of 10. And so we are benefiting from that. The community's benefiting from that. And we've got an indoor football team here in Tulsa now.
All right, other football fans, do your part now. How do they get those season tickets?
Yeah, absolutely. You can go to our website, TulsaOilersFootball.com. You can inquire about season tickets, group tickets as well. Also, 918-632-7825 is our phone number. It's the same phone number as the Tulsa Oilers hockey team, under the same ownership. So definitely give us a call. We can help you out with any questions you have about being a part of the family here for the Tulsa Oilers football team. And our season tickets are going like crazy. So
give the ISOs a pop now. They're like, open camp right now, an exhibition game Saturday.
Yeah, absolutely. So the Oilers hockey team, first day of training camp here, hit the ground running. A lot of good characters in that locker room for sure. We're excited. Game in Allen, Texas for preseason on Wednesday, and then our first exhibition game at home here in quite a while on Saturday against the Wichita Thunder. So you can get your tickets, just inquire, same phone number, and we'll send you the link to buy tickets.
That's at the Tulsa Ice Center on Saturday.
Yes, man. The Oilers Ice Center right there off of Mingo, and it'll be the only preseason game you'll get a chance to see there this year.
Luke Hamilton, the voice of the Oilers indoor football pro team coming up in March. Also works for their media, and we got something for you, too. Come back and enjoy Billy Sims' barbecue with us.
Thank you, sir. Right. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Luke.
Absolutely.
We come back. The one and only Robert Taylor, great friend of mine at Sports Memorabilia. Don't believe the bat he has with him. That's next.
You did it, Tulsa. You name the team.
We name the team.
You name the team. The Tulsa Oilers indoor football team kicks off in March, Saturday nights, 7 p.m., BOK Center. Season tickets are on sale now. Go to TulsaOilersFootball.com. That's TulsaOilersFootball.com to get your season tickets now. Don't miss your chance to experience the fast pace, helmet hitting, pad popping excitement of professional indoor football. TulsaOilersFootball.com. TulsaOilersFootball.com.
Josie's on a vacation far away. Come around and talk it over.
Times may change, you know, but the feeling stays the same.
Stay alive and keep it undercover. I just want to use your love tonight. Whoa. I don't want to lose.
Live your greatest hits tonight at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa.
At Rogers State University, we keep things personal.
It all starts here.
We make sure our graduates get the most out of their education.
RSU has campuses in Claremore, Bartlesville, and Pryor, with on-campus housing and a wide variety of programs to suit your needs.
It all starts here.
Rogers State University.
High fly ball, deep left. There it goes, soaring into history. He's done it. He has done it. 62. Aaron Judge is the American League single season home run leader. The AL King. Case closed.
Well, that historic 60-second home run for Aaron Judge is also going to be pretty good for the guy that caught the baseball. Memorabilia collectors looking for that ball. Seven figures, already talked about it. The guy knows all about that. Robert Taylor, he is the sports memorabilia collector of the state of Oklahoma, maybe even more so than that. Robert, what do you think about that baseball? What's it going to go for?
They say it's going to be $2 million or more. I mean, the guy's an instant millionaire.
Golly.
And crazy.
They'll take that. Some collector will take it and he'll resell it, or what's the?
It's going to go up for auction, yes.
So obviously, $2 million is the starting price.
Right.
Wow. You've got something pretty special there. Let's talk about an Aaron Judge signed baseball bat. What's this all about?
Well, in 2017, when he broke Mark McGwire's record, they were selling these.
That was the rookie.
Rookie record for home runs. 2018, they came out with these bats, and they weren't supposed to be released until a certain day, but I talked to the people that had the bats in because I was going to go see Aaron at the Yankees in hopes to try to get it signed. And so I got lucky and got bat number 4 of limited edition of 2017. They weren't signed, and went to Texas, see the Yankees play, and was able to get Aaron Judge.
You were saying he is really a nice guy as he seems on TV too.
Oh, he's super nice. He's not like your typical major league ball player. You know, some of them
Won't even sign for kids anymore.
Don't want to give you the time of day or anything. But he came over and was interacting with fans. And, you know, we just happened to be standing by some of his friends. But, you know, I've seen him, well, up until COVID, you know, I've seen him for 2 or 3 years play. And he's always interacted with fans and signed autographs. Every game I've been.
He had a great story too about you helped take some pictures of fans and got them under the ropes. And then he was about to leave, and all of a sudden you're on the Yes Network too, right?
Yes, they showing me and Aaron Judge, hit me and Aaron and my friend talking to him, and shook Aaron's hand, and he kind of gave me a hug, you know, pat on the back, and then looked, and there's a Yes Network TV crew right there. And then when I got back to the hotel and I turned my phone on, my phone has exploded with. Some of my friends back in New York said, I can't believe you never told me you were friends with Aaron Judge. You know,
but you never know, of course, but you even have, I want to show some of his cards here. Show me this first card of his.
This is a 2014 Bowman draft pick card.
Right there, yeah.
And, you know.
Is that considered the rookie card, or is this?
Yeah, one of these rookies. Okay. They make so many rookie cards now.
Oh, gosh.
But there's some. Really, really limited print rookie cards that came out already signed, you know, that he signed and they put in packs. So those are very, very expensive. This is his 2015 Topps Pro debut card. I was able to get signed.
That was signed too. You signed
it. This is the one I got signed when the Yes Network was going on.
Right.
This is his 2018 Topps Heritage. Topps started doing these Heritage cards. This is actual design of a 1969 Topps baseball card, what they look like.
Yeah,
so they go back, they're up to 1973s now of making, you know, they make a set of cards every year in the Heritage of, you know, old designs of baseball cards. So I just thought that was a nice looking card with that rookie trophy and stuff. And so I wanted to get it signed and I was able to do it.
And just so good to hear about that because you hear more and more stories about athletes. I understand that. These guys don't want to sign because they think, well, okay, they're going to take that and go right on eBay or YouTube and sell it right away and stuff. So they're very protective of that.
There's actually a, you can Google it going around right now. A kid, I guess a parent sent a kid over to a guy signing autographs and some player. And the player was trying to interact with him and he said, well, my dad sent me over. So. Instead of signing the ball, he said, quit sending your kids to get autographs for you on the ball. So that's a quit using your kids to get autographs, I think is what he said.
Well, you've been nice enough to bring your Mickey Mantle rookie card with you at times and that, but I don't know, is that you that sold it for $12.6 million?
No, I wish it was, but I wish that card was mine, I should say.
Wow.
It's just
all-time record, right?
All-time record, and that's not the best card out there.
What?
No, that was only graded a 9.5. There's three PSA 10s, and they said if a PSA 10, one of those 10s would ever come to auction, it'd go for over $50
million. 50 million.
50 million.
The one we're talking about was sold for $12.6 million at auction, all-time record of baseball card. And then I also caught my eye was a jersey worn by basketball legend Michael Jordan in game one of the 1998 NBA playoffs. Sold for a record $10.1 million.
There's actually the record for a game-worn jersey right now belongs to a soccer player.
Oh, wow, of course.
I can't think of his name because I'm not a big soccer fan or collector, but it sold for a lot of
Ronaldo,
money.
Ronaldo, one of those guys like that.
I think it is Ronaldo.
Ronaldo, that makes sense, How much did it sell for?
It was quite a bit.
Over the $10.1 million. Golly. Yeah. Well, what item should collectors look for? I mean, you want to get that original autograph or what? You want to start collecting, what's your advice?
Well, if you can afford them, you know, even the lower grade Mickey Mantle cards, every time something like that $12.6 million sells, like my 52 Mantle is not in that shape, but it's in lower, you know, condition, the prices just go up. I mean, it's just, it's crazy what the prices are for these cards, what stuff is selling for now.
Well, Robert Taylor, a great question. Thank you for bringing all
You're
the Aaron Judge stuff.
Anytime.
We have some for you here. This is our Billy Sims Barbecue. Lovely bride.
Does Billy know you're giving these away?
Oh, yeah. He gave it to us, too.
All right.
So, appreciate it, buddy.
I'll text Billy and tell him thanks.
Robert Taylor, he is the sports memorabilia guy in this area here. And again, previous to the Aaron Judge thing. Right back with more Oklahoma Sports Scene. Stay with us.
The Tulsa Oilers are back on the ice with a new owner, a new look, and a new attitude.
Save big on season tickets today. 2022-23 season. Tickets starting as low as $17 per month. Get your season tickets at TulsaOilers.com. TulsaOilers.com. Experience hard-hitting, glove-dropping, pulse-pounding, glass-rattling kind of thrill. Season tickets available now at TulsaOilers.com. This is your town, your team, your Tulsa Oilers are back.
The Oklahoma Sports Hall of Fame, home of the Paycom Jim Thorpe Award, is a treasure trove of memorabilia honoring Oklahoma sports legends. For museum hours or to schedule a tour, go to OklahomaSportsHallOfFame.org.
My name is Dr. Brittany Ells. Here at Tulsa Bone and Joint Urgent Care, we treat a lot of athletes for wrist injuries, anything from sprains and fractures, elbow and shoulder injuries. Right here on site, we have the ability to do x-rays for your student athlete. We also have the ability to put them in a wrist brace or a knee brace if needed. And we have the ability to refer them to an orthopedic surgeon for follow-up care. We're an orthopedic urgent care and we have a walk-in availability. You don't need an appointment. One of the things that makes our urgent care unique is that it is physician run. We appreciate being able to care for your student athletes.
Get down with Monsters and Money this Rocktober at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa. Win up to $1 million October 15th, 22nd, and 29th. Take a chance and be one of 15 lucky winners rocking their way to the bank. Then, don't miss our $10,000 costume party. Dress to impress October 29th from 7 p.m. to 2 a.m. and become one of 10 scary winners to claim some cash. Only at Hard Rock Hotel and Casino, Tulsa.
Welcome back to Oklahoma Sports Scene here at Billy Sims Barbecue in the Farm Shopping Center in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Concussion. It is the hot topic this season, and discussing with us, Tulsa Bone and Joint Center, one of their specialists, is Dr. Chris Crane. Yeah, I know, I said the same thing too. Seriously, you're a doctor. He is, believe it. Give us your background, in fact, Chris.
Oh, sure. I went to Broken Arrow High School, class of 07, and then went to University of Tulsa, did an undergraduate degree there, went straight to med school at OU. And now I'm practicing with Tulsa Bone and Joint. You got a clinic out in Sand Springs.
Also team position for Sepulpa. Hi, mm-hmm. Is that right?
Yeah.
All right, well, since the NFL's Miami Dolphin quarterback, Tuiloa, took that hit in the game and staggered and fell on the field and came back in the game. But later, of course, he returned to a game 4 days later and got knocked out again by Cincinnati. Everybody's been talking about concussions. And that was really scary.
Yeah, and it's a lot of concussions are more subtle. His was not. His yeah. was very much a stagger, and the second hit, he had a posture of fencing that.
I've never seen that before. The hand was shaking.
Yeah, that's a sign of a pretty powerful concussion hit, and it just the communication between the brain and the arms gets disrupted, and you get some interesting posturing that's hard to hide.
Yeah, and they mentioned a big issue of this. The NFL Player Association, the NFL, mm-hmm. they protect these players. They have neurosurgeons there or neurologists right. there on the same. What happened? How did that fall through the cracks here?
Well, essentially what happened is they took him back for assessment and they went to evaluate him for concussion, and he told them that his injury was due to back and due to leg injuries that he had previously reported, and that's why he staggered off the field. So they went and looked it up, and sure enough, he'd reported those injuries, but they didn't re-examine him then. So he played the rest of that game, but then got that second hit 4 days later, and that was the significant injury that could have killed him.
Well, what's involved in testing a player, either the sideline or taking him back in the locker room?
Sure, and it's a complex thing. It's a checklist typically, because there are so many different ways that a concussion can present, so many different symptoms you can have, and it's not that you have to have a certain number or that you have to have a certain severity. It's a constellation of the symptoms that you get. And it's important, too, that the player report those honestly. And they can be nausea, headache, they can be sensitivity to light or sound, or even more things that are kind of hard to quantify, like just feeling in a fog or dizzy or things like that.
Well, more closer to home, certainly, as all Oklahoma football fans are very much aware, Dylan Gabriel took a vicious hit in the second quarter of the TCU game. He was giving himself, sliding, and then guy hit him right in the helmet there. Got a penalty, but worse than that, of course, Dylan had to leave the game. And I was proud of Oklahoma. Here, the biggest game of the season, Texas. So much pressure. Here's your number one quarterback. But by gosh, they stood firm and they held him out of that Texas game. And obviously the best thing for Dylan Gabriel.
Yeah, it is. And that's what this awareness that's growing after Tua's injury and the high-profile injuries that we've got is that this is serious. This is not something you just shake off. This is not something light. A second hit, if you've not fully recovered from the first concussion, can be deadly. It can legitimately kill you. And so taking this to a serious level is something I'm glad to see teams doing for the sake of athletes.
Now, for some of the old-school football players out there, and I like to count myself as one of those, except I never hit anybody hard enough to get a concussion. But it was always just, got your bell rung, how many fingers am I holding up? Back off the field you went.
Yeah, and as more evidence comes out that there's just more and more long-term damage building up, that you can't just keep having concussions and shaking them off like they're nothing. And to take those seriously, and not just for the sake of the performance of the athlete or even their school performance is affected too, but for long term, the chronic traumatic encephalopathy that we talk about, or CTE, and the chronic issues with memory and mood that can pop up with that, that's getting more attention.
That's what I want to bring up. I'm glad you pronounced CTE for me there. Back on for that though. But that is something you don't know until it's posthumous, right? It's in an autopsy.
Yeah, the only reliable way that we have to find that is an autopsy and looking at proteins that are in the brain in abnormal levels and abnormal types. And that's not something we have a good test for now. We kind of can speculate about it with the symptoms that they have and sort of the memory issues and other things that they report to us. But the level of damage is just not something we can measure.
First reported by Pittsburgh Steelers All-Pro Hall of Fame center, who's passed away, Mike Webster, first player diagnosed with a CTE illness and captured in a great movie called Concussion, which you should watch too, Doc, that Will Smith stars in. Really a very powerful movie. Others that NFL legends were diagnosed after they passed away, the guys, Ollie Mattson, Cookie Gilchrist, Wally Hilgenberg, Kansas City Chiefs player, Javon Belcher, actually shot himself and his girlfriend in 2013. Then after the autopsy showed signs of CTE. That's how serious it gets.
Yeah, and it, you know, impairing judgment and impairing mood and processing are part of the CTE constellation of symptoms. So it's hard.
You know, as a high school physician too, and taking care of the, you mentioned the Sepulpa football team. This was staggering to me. This just came out recently. PBS's Frontline report noted that 80% of deceased high school, college, and pro football players who underwent posthumous brain examinations tested positive for CTE, 80%.
80%, and that's a staggering number. I mean, that is the vast majority of players, and that's got to be something that we take serious.
I would try to adjust for the rules, no contact with the helmet. They're working like crazy on the helmets, of course. You see in the practice now.
They're trying.
Back on the tennis ball they put on their heads, a little padding and stuff.
Yeah.
Is there an answer out there?
So far, the helmets don't seem to be solving it. And part of the answer that we're really looking for early on is better concussion protocols. The Players League and the NFL got together and added ataxia, which Tua showed, to the list of the things that we look for in concussion and the no-go symptoms that we talk about.
Don't want to scare the parents to death or the kids to death, but again, what are some of the signs they should look for?
Well, it'll be confusion. It'll be things like not remembering the play is one that I commonly see. You ask them, hey, how did you tackle him? Did you make the catch? They can't recall. Just looking for things like headache, sensitivity to light, asking the same questions multiple times. It's something that it can be very subtle. It can be a subtle shift in just their baseline, their emotions, and their day-to-day. So it's tough, and it's something doctors have to work hard to look close at, too.
Dr. Chris Crane. Yes, he is old enough to be a doctor. Congratulations again. Here's something for you and your wife. Come join us at Billy Sims Barbecue. Enjoy dinner on us sometime.
Appreciate you.
Chris, thank you much. And thank you, Tulsa Bone and Joint, for sending us out. That's the hot topic, concussions. Dr. Crane filling you in. We're going to be right back with an OU football legend. Stay with us.
The 2022 Remington Park Thoroughbred season continues through December 17th. Racing starts at 7 p.m. Normal weekly schedule is Wednesday through Saturday. Oklahoma Classics Night is Friday, October 21st, with more than $1 million on the line for the top Oklahoma breds. For more information on Remington Park Racing and Casino Gaming, visit RemingtonPark.com.
Hi, I'm Dr. Caleb Nelly with Tulsa Bone and Joint in Owosso.
And I'm Dr. Ian Goodman with Tulsa Bone and Joint in Owosso, and we are your team physicians for the Owosso Rams.
I'm Zach McGinty.
I'm Kate Grady.
I'm Destry Millsap.
and we are the athletic trainers for the Owasso Rams.
Here's some of the services that we provide in the Tulsa Bone and Joint Athletic Training Facility.
Billy Sims knows barbecue. How about 9 meats, including brisket, chicken, pork, turkey, and ribs? Just to name a few, and 7 homestyle sides. We start early to slow smoke the most delicious meats for over 12 hours.
Every day.
Wherever you want, online, dine-in, curbside, or carryout. We've had a passion for over 15 years of serving delicious barbecue to people like you. Billy Sims has fast, drop-in friendly neighborhood service, loud enough for a tailgate and fancy enough for a wedding. Like we said, Billy Sims knows barbecue.
The Tulsa Oilers are back on the ice with a new owner, a new look, and a new attitude. Save big on season tickets today, 2022-23 season. Tickets starting as low as $17 per month. Get your season tickets at TulsaOilers.com. TulsaOilers.com. Experience hard-hitting, glove-dropping, pulse-pounding, glass-rattling kind of thrill. Season tickets available now at TulsaOilers.com. This is your town, your team, your Tulsa Oilers are back.
This is Oklahoma Sports Scene. If you Sooner fans are still struggling, let's take you back to the past. Make you feel better about this now is Tinker Owens, one of the great OU football receivers, two-time All-American, just inducted in the Oklahoma Sports Hall of Fame. Of course, the younger brother of the great Steve Owens, a Heisman Trophy winner of the Sooners. Had a chance to visit with him and first congratulated him on all these Hall of Fames he's been inducted into.
You know, fortunately, I've been very blessed. I went to my high school Hall of Fame. I guess it was 2019, the year after Steve went in, which they just started it the year before. So Steve was the first one to go in. And then, of course, I was the second class, and it was a great honor. And then I went to the Sugar Bowl Hall of Fame in 2020. So it's been a pretty good run. I was shocked when I got the call from Mike James and my brother Steve that I was going to the Hall of Fame. And I actually called my wife, and hell, I started crying on the phone. So I guess I was pretty damn excited about it.
Oh, again, Tinker, hey, people sure know your story. Of course, you're the seven-year younger brother of Steve, who won the 1969 Heisman Trophy, and now you're both in the Hall of Fame. And I know your brother has been much more than just an older brother for you. He's been an inspiration to your entire career.
Well, he has. As I said in my speech, I said, you know, Steve inspired me as a young kid. The way he worked, his work ethic, to watch him work out in football and then watch him in track. And he would literally run until he got sick, and he would stay out there longer than anybody else. And I kind of got that from him. And so, you know, I was a guy that always stayed after practice and caught more passes and tried to get better. You know, I wasn't the biggest guy in the world or the fastest guy in the world. And I always thought I had to work a little harder than a lot of guys that had more talent than I had. And fortunately, it all worked out.
Well, you're both the pride of Miami, Oklahoma. You, a 1972 War Dog graduate, led in that year to the 3A state championship. And then the recruiting wars started. Everybody, of course, said, well, gosh, do you want to try to follow in not just the footsteps of your brother playing, but the footsteps of a Heisman Trophy winning brother? I know several schools recruited you, Tinker. And what did it come down to? I know you made a trip to Arkansas, but I know Steve told me he was going to threaten to kill you if you didn't go to OU. So tell us about that.
Well, he threatened to kick my butt. He didn't threaten to kill me, but I wanted to go to Oklahoma all along. It was just a matter of, I knew I wasn't going to be the player Steve was. I knew I wasn't going to win a Heisman Trophy. I just wanted to go somewhere where I could play. And when it came down to it, Arkansas was really recruiting me as a defensive back because I was all state safety and on the defensive side. And I just decided that, you know, go for it. And like I said, Steve said he's going to kick my butt, so that had a lot to do with it. But, you know, Leon Cross just passed away.
Right.
And Leon, you know, he believed in me. And he had to talk Chuck Fairbanks into taking me. And it really came down to the story as I heard it. They had one scholarship left, and it was either going to be Steve Largent or myself. And obviously, Steve had a Hall of Fame career and Hall of Famer in the NFL and had a phenomenal career and was a great player. I played against him in the All-State game, and Steve's a wonderful guy. But I'm sure glad they made me the offer and not Steve Largent. But anyway, he had a great career at TU, as you know, and
yes,
went on to the Seahawks and just had a phenomenal career.
Well, let's talk about your career. Not too bad. A two-time All-American as a receiver, and that's pretty hard to do when Oklahoma threw the ball, what, 10 or 12 times a year in the wishbone back then in the 70s?
Well, we didn't throw many, Chris. I think I caught – the least I caught my senior year, I think, was 12. and the most I caught in a year was 18. And I think that was my freshman year. So I think I caught like 18, 17, and it kind of went down from there. Of course, you know, Switzer didn't have to throw the football, as you know. When you got Joe Washington, Elvis Peacock, and Jimmy Luttrell, and Horace Ivory, and Wayman Clark, and all the great backs we had. Steve Davis, of course, the quarterback. God rest his soul. And, yes. and just had a phenomenal defense, you know, as well.
Well, Tinker, that was my first 2 years. You were a freshman in Oklahoma, back-to-back national champion, 74-75 covering you and the Sooner team then. Some I'll always remember. Those are some incredible teams, both offensively and especially defensively.
Well, we knew as an offense that we could depend on the defense if we ever got in a bind. And unfortunately, we lost to Kansas my senior year, which we should have never lost the game. But, you know, you can't turn the ball over 9 times in a football game and expect to win. So that was the offense's fault, not the defense's fault. The defense was out on the field all day long. But, you know, to play with such great players, with, of course, the Salmons and Jimbo Elrod and Rod Schoat, Randy Hughes, you know, just so many great, great players on the defense side of the ball. And I know in the Michigan game my senior year, I knew that if I was a punter my senior year, and I was in the back of the end zone toward the end of the game, and I knew if they blocked it, then I knew that they could end up winning the game. We ended up winning the game 14-6, the way it worked out. But I got rid of the ball. I kicked it about 35 yards. I took about a half a step to kick it because I knew they were going to rush, and I was in the very back of the end zone. I knew I couldn't step out of the end zone, so I got rid of the ball, but I knew one thing. They weren't going to score on our defense again. Shouldn't have scored the first time, except we had a fumble down toward the goal line and backed up, and they got the ball about the 5-yard line. They scored. Otherwise, they wouldn't even have scored in the game. So I knew, hey, turn it over to the Selmans and the rest of the team, and we'll win the national championship, because we knew Ohio State had lost to UCLA in the Rose Bowl prior to our game in the Orange Bowl that night. And so, you know, that was the national championship on the line with a chance to go back-to-back, which is very rare, as you know, and mainly to play on a team my junior year to go 11-0, the best team that was never seen. Couldn't be on television, couldn't go to a bowl game. And we still won a national championship. So that tells you how great a teams we had at Oklahoma.
Well, then, Tink, you were the 95th pick, fourth round of the 1976 NFL draft, and went on to the New Orleans Saints. Talk about your NFL pro career.
Well, you know, it was good in a way that I went to New Orleans because they weren't loading on the receivers. You know, Dallas Cowboys always made you feel like they were going to draft you. And they told everybody that. Gil Brandt. Everybody was going to be a Cowboy. Well, I think Kyle Davis was the only guy on our team that ended up being a Cowboy, nobody else. But, you know, to get drafted, Hank Stram calling me and telling me, how would you like to be a New Orleans Saint, Tinker? And I said, well, it sounds good to me. So I was fortunate. I went to a team that wasn't loaded at receiver and had an opportunity to make the team. If I'd have gone to Dallas, I wouldn't have made the team. You know, they had a guy named Drew Pearson and Tony Hill and just some phenomenal receivers. So I was very fortunate to go to New Orleans to have an opportunity to make a team. And it's very stressful, as you know, going through training camp. And, you know, we started off with 13 receivers and ended up keeping 3. Ugh. And so the pressure, they actually kept 4 in the first week. They cut one of them the season. And so I ended up being 1 of 3 guys to make that team. And you know, I didn't have a great career. I had a good career. Unfortunately, I blew my knee my second season, the last preseason game going into the season I was starting, and came back the next year. They drafted a guy named Wes Chandler, which I know you've heard of. And Wes was a phenomenal player out of Florida. And I started ahead of him my third year. I started ahead of him. For that season, well, I saw the writing on the wall. The last 2 games of the season, they called me in and said, hey, we're going to let Wes get some playing time at receiver. Well, guess what? I go to training camp the next year, and I'm second team on depth chart. So I kind of saw it coming. But Wes was a great player. Nothing against him. It was just the way it was. And he went on to have a great career in New Orleans and on to San Diego and had a great career there in Eric Coryell offense.
Well, Tinker, you're a multiple Hall of Famer, not only as a player, but as a person, too. It's been great to know you, great to cover you through all these years. And congratulations to both you and to Steve. You're tremendous Sooners and an awful proud of both of you.
Hey, I appreciate it, Chris. You're a good man.
So the Owenses, Tinker and Steve, bring to five the number of families of multiple enshrinees, including the Wainers, Paul and Lloyd, Big Poison, Little Poison from baseball fame, football Selmans, that's of course talking about Lucius, Dewey, and Leroy, along with the wrestling Smith family, John, Pat, and just inducted this year in the class, Leroy III, and media icons, Bob Berry Sr. and his son, Bob Berry Jr. When we come back to Remington Report from Oklahoma City. Also, I'll have my Lincoln 2 cents worth. You Sooner fans may not like what I have to tell you.
The 2022 Remington Park Thoroughbred season continues through December 17th. Racing starts at 7 p.m. Normal weekly schedule is Wednesday through Saturday. Oklahoma Classics Night is Friday, October 21st, with more than $1 million on the line for the top Oklahoma breds. For more information on Remington Park Racing and Casino Gaming, visit RemingtonPark.com.
You did it, Tulsa. You name the team.
We name the team.
You name the team. The Tulsa Oilers indoor football team kicks off in March, Saturday nights, 7 p.m., BOK Center. Season tickets are on sale now. Go to TulsaOilersFootball.com. That's TulsaOilersFootball.com to get your season tickets now. Don't miss your chance to experience the fast pace, helmet hitting, pad popping excitement of professional indoor football. TulsaOilersFootball.com. TulsaOilersFootball.com.
Time now for this week's Remington Report. Our Thoroughbred Race Report will go to Oklahoma City and our announcer, Dale Day, with another jockey profile.
We are nearing the halfway point of the Remington Park season with jockey Christian Torres, one of the top stories of the meet, as he leads the rider standings in his first full year in Oklahoma City.
Back it out, but it makes sense. Mexican Wonder Boy has fifth as they pass the quarter pole. The half goes in 44.88 seconds into the stretch. Flash of Mischief rolling huge outside of Empire of Gold. This pair clear now by four. El Pando into third, Macron fourth. Give it everything, trying for a minor award. It's Flash of Mischief. Second in the Oklahoma Derby last year. First in the David M. Vance Sprint this year. Flash of Mischief easily by six.
Flash of Mischief winning the $150,000 David Vance Sprint on the Oklahoma Derby Day undercard provided Christian Torres with his biggest win of the season so far. Through October 5th, he leads the jockey standings with 32 wins, finishing in the top three in 57% of his races. Torres began his riding career in 2019 at Gulfstream Park in Florida. After racing at Oaklawn this spring, his move to Remington Park is all part of a master plan for year-round circuit success.
I decided to stay up here and do like Texas and Oklahoma so I can pick up business for Oakland, and the people are responding good and I'm liking it up here.
Torres is enjoying immediate success at Remington Park thanks to hard work and riding first call for leading trainer Carl Broberg.
Being better than what I expected. I was expecting a big meet. Coming up from an injury, I started in Texas, and from Texas to here, it was a transition, and it's been better than what I expected. Carl is very supportive to me. He's always been supportive since I first got to Oakland, and we have done pretty good together, and I'm very grateful with him that he's giving me all the opportunities.
Torres is already approaching the $1 million mark in mount earnings and is well on pace for a possible $2 million season in his first year at Remington Park. The Oklahoma Classics take place on Friday, October 21st at Remington Park, with the Oklahoma Craft Classics featuring top local breweries and their beers a big part of the evening this year. Racing continues Wednesday through Saturday. First race nightly is 7:07 p.m. Central Time. For more information, please visit RemingtonPark.com. In Oklahoma City at Remington Park, I'm Dale Day. Now back to Sportscene.
So at the end of each one of our Oklahoma Sportscene shows, I'm adding my Lincoln's 2 cents worth. Some of the Sooner fans may not like this, but let's call it the way it is. Texas 49, Oklahoma nothing. Now, the longtime Austin American statesman, very respected sports columnist, good friend of ours, by the way, Kirk Bowles, wrote after the beatdown, the Sooners, now 3-3, were not OU, they were 0-U in the Cotton Bowl Saturday. The most lopsided defeat in the 118 episodes of the Oklahoma-Texas rivalry. The first time OU has been shut out since 1965. How long has that been? Let me tell you how long that's been. That's the year I graduated from high school in Warren, Michigan. I'm not that great with math, but I figured out 65, 22, carry the 57 years. 57 years since Oklahoma was shut out and embarrassed like that at the Cotton Bowl. Look at all of OU's problems. It's really hard right now to find three more wins in their final six games to become bowl eligible. That means in danger is OU's streak of 23 consecutive bowl games, second longest in all of college football, second only to Georgia with 25. Last time OU did not go to a bowl game was the end of the John Blake era. That was 1998. But a more immediate concern for Sooner Nation is that its last two losses, TCU 55-24, UT 49-0, listen, this marks the first time in the last 128 years of Oklahoma football they've been beaten on the football field by more than 30 points in two consecutive games. So what do you do now? Well, you can be a real diehard OU fan and hang on to that Sooner Schooner, support them all the way. Or you can maybe jump off and think about the Orange guys, Oklahoma State, undefeated, playing well, want to support the Cowboys. All right, if you OU fans can't do that, then here's my next advice to you. Go for OU West. That'd be the USC Trojans. After all, they have our coach, they have our quarterback, they have our receiver, they have the top high school running back recruit that was supposed to come to Oklahoma. If you want to support football, I guess go USC, go Trojans. And that's Lincoln's 2 cents worth. See you next week on Oklahoma Sports Scene.